Hello, everyone. Imagine yourself in a situation where you have to make a crucial decision that could change the course of your life. For example, you have a stable, well-paid job, but you're not happy. You've always dreamed of becoming an entrepreneur, but that means quitting your job, accepting financial uncertainty, and facing the unknown. This dilemma perfectly illustrates what existentialism seeks to explore: the freedom of choice, the anxiety that accompanies it, and the search for authenticity. Existentialism is a philosophy that focuses on the human condition, freedom, and individual responsibility. It involves understanding that each person is responsible for giving meaning to their own life, despite the challenges and uncertainties, but above all, despite social and cultural constraints. It's in this context that we will discover Søren Kierkegaard, a thinker whose works continue to resonate in our quest for meaning and authenticity. His ideas continue to influence our understanding of human existence. Far from abstract systems and general theories, Kierkegaard invites us to reflect on our own lives, our choices, and our relationship to existence. His unique approach, blending philosophical reflection, psychological introspection, and spiritual questioning, makes him a precursor of existentialism and modern psychology. But who was Søren Kierkegaard really? Why do his ideas still resonate so strongly today, nearly two centuries after his birth? Well, this is what we will discover together. For that, it is essential to understand the context in which Kierkegaard lived and developed his thought. His philosophy is intimately linked to his era and personal history. We are at the beginning of the 19th century. Europe is in full intellectual effervescence, a period of radical transformations. It's the era of the Industrial Revolution, where cities expand, factories multiply, and a new working class emerges. These rapid upheavals come with new questions about the individual's place in society and the meaning of human existence. Intellectually, it's the age of Romanticism, which exalts feelings, imagination, and individuality, and that of German idealism with thinkers like Hegel. At the same time, science progresses, challenging some traditional beliefs. The church, on its part, faces challenges with the rationalism of the Enlightenment and growing secularization. Born in 1813 in Copenhagen, Søren Kierkegaard grew up in a family deeply marked by Pietist Christianity. Pietist Christianity here means emphasizing personal faith, heartfelt devotion, and practical holiness. His father, Michael Kierkegaard, was a successful business person, but was tormented by a sense of guilt linked to events from his youth. This religious and melancholic family atmosphere profoundly influenced the young Søren, and especially his relation with his father. Kierkegaard studied theology at the University of Copenhagen, but his academic journey was far from linear. A brilliant student, he became interested in philosophy, literature, history, and even the sciences. During his studies, he led the life of a dandy, frequenting cafes and theaters, often hiding his inner turmoil behind a facade of irony. This period influenced his reflections on the aesthetic stage of existence. In 1840, at the age of 27, Kierkegaard became engaged to Regine Olsen but broke off their engagement a year later. This decision, which tormented him throughout his life, was motivated by complex reasons. Convinced that his inner struggles made him unfit for marriage, and feeling a vocation as a writer and thinker incompatible with conjugal life, he chose to end the engagement. This breakup inspired his reflections on the religious stage of existence. The relationship with Regine Olsen became a recurring theme in Kierkegaard's work, notably inspiring the character of Cordelia in The Seducer's Diary. After the breakup, Kierkegaard devoted himself entirely to writing and philosophical reflection, publishing his first major work, Either Or, in 1843 under the pseudonym Victor Eremita. He then published a series of works, often under different pseudonyms. This practice, using pen names or writing under pseudonyms, was not merely a literary game, but a philosophical strategy to explore different existential perspectives and engage the reader in active reflection. He died in 1855 at the age of 42, leaving behind a monumental body of work that would significantly influence 20th century philosophy and theology. His ideas on individual existence, choice, anxiety, and faith directly inspired the 20th century existentialist movement. They also impacted various fields such as psychology, literature, and even politics. Thinkers like Jean-Paul Sartre, Albert Camus, and Martin Heidegger acknowledged their debt to the Danish philosopher. In a world marked by uncertainty and the search for meaning, Kierkegaard invites us to explore the different stages of existence and offers a framework for reflecting on our own life paths and the choices that define us. And it is precisely this exploration of the stages of existence that we will delve into in the rest of this podcast. We will see how Kierkegaard, through works like The Seducer's Diary and The Postscript, also known as Concluding Unscientific Postscript to the Philosophical Fragments, invites us to reflect on the different ways to give meaning to our lives. You will find in the first pinned comment a link to The Seducer's Diary PDF. So, what are the stages of existence? This theory, which permeates his entire body of work, offers us a unique perspective on personal development and the quest for meaning. It is a kind of existential progression through three stages of existence, namely, aesthetic, ethical, and religious. These stages are not merely abstract categories but ways of living, attitudes towards existence. Each stage represents a different level of commitment and self-awareness. However, we must also keep in mind that Kierkegaard's aim was not to provide us with ready-made answers, but to encourage us to embark on our own existential quest. But how do these abstract concepts translate into the reality of human existence? To illustrate these ideas, Kierkegaard often uses fictional characters, personifications of different modes of life. This is precisely what he does in The Seducer's Diary, a work that immerses us in the heart of the aesthetic stage. So, The Seducer's Diary is a part of Kierkegaard's major work, Either Or, published in 1843. This complex work is presented as the intimate journal of a seducer named Johannes, who meticulously details his strategy to seduce a young girl, Cordelia. This narrative technique allows Kierkegaard to create a distance between himself and the content of the text. It is not an apology for seduction, but a critical exploration of the limitations of the aesthetic mode of life, immersing us in the mind of a seducer. Johannes, the protagonist of The Seducer's Diary, is the archetype of the individual at the aesthetic stage of existence. Intelligent, cultured, and charismatic, he devotes all his energy to the pursuit of aesthetic pleasure, particularly through seduction. For Johannes, seduction is an art, a form of aesthetic creation. He does not simply seek to satisfy his sexual desires, but to orchestrate situations, manipulate emotions, and create moments of beauty and intensity. Every detail of his seduction strategy is meticulously planned and executed. But what really motivates Johannes? Is it truly love or desire for Cordelia? Or is it rather the pleasure of the game itself, the thrill of the conquest? Johannes embodies the pursuit of aesthetic pleasure in all its forms, living his life as a work of art where every moment must be savored for its beauty or intensity. He cultivates a keen sensitivity to beauty, whether in nature, art, or human relationships. Always living in the present, he seeks to maximize each moment without projecting into the future or committing to long-term engagements. Each encounter with Cordelia is designed as a fleeting work of art, valuing the instant. So Johannes develops a complex and refined seduction strategy, revealing the nature of the aesthetic stage and its ethical implications. He plans every step of the seduction with incredible precision, studying Cordelia, her environment, and her habits. He orchestrates chance encounters and manipulates circumstances to favor his project. He plays with Cordelia's emotions, alternating between attention and indifference, provoking jealousy, and creating an aura of mystery around himself. His goal is to fascinate Cordelia and make her emotionally dependent. A master in the art of communication, he uses poetry, letters, and conversations, his language rich in metaphors, allusions, and innuendos. He also understands the importance of appearances, working on his image to present himself as a mysterious and fascinating man, creating elaborate setups to impress Cordelia. Compared to our time, apparently, seduction strategies have not evolved much since the 19th century. This entire seduction strategy raises important ethical questions. Does Johannes treat Cordelia as an end in herself, or merely as a means to satisfy his own aesthetic pleasure? Can his manipulation be justified even in the name of creating intense aesthetic experiences? For Johannes, emotions are raw material to sculpt. He seeks to provoke in Cordelia, and in himself, intense and varied emotional states. Love, jealousy, anxiety, excitement are all colors on his emotional palette. However, he carefully avoids any real commitment. His goal is not to build a lasting relationship with Cordelia, but to experience the intensity of seduction. Once the conquest is accomplished, he is ready to move on because boredom is his sworn enemy. Johannes is constantly in search of new experiences, new sensations, and is characteristic of the aesthetic stage. So, my little audience, if your boyfriend or girlfriend suddenly disappears, don't worry. They might just be in their aesthetic phase, chasing the next thrill and avoiding the mundane. But the question is this incessant quest for aesthetic pleasure truly satisfying? Johannes himself sometimes seems to doubt it. There are moments when he reveals a form of melancholy, a sense of emptiness that all his aesthetic sophistication cannot fill. And I quote, "What am I doing? Am I beguiling her? By no means. That would be of no avail to me. Am I stealing her heart? By no means. In fact, have I preferred that the girl I am going to love should keep her heart? What am I doing then? I am shaping for myself a heart like unto hers. An artist paints his beloved. That is now his joy. A sculptor shapes her. This I too am doing, but in an intellectual sense. She does not know that I possess this image, and therein really lies my falsification." And yes, through Johannes, Kierkegaard shows the limits and dangers of the aesthetic mode of life. Despite its sophistication and refinement, this way of living is fundamentally superficial. Johannes is incapable of truly committing to a relationship, condemned to a series of intense but fleeting experiences. Life at the aesthetic stage lacks continuity, with each experience being isolated and disconnected from a broader life project, leading to a sense of emptiness and meaninglessness. In his pursuit of aesthetic pleasure, Johannes treats others, especially Cordelia, as instruments for his own satisfaction, an attitude that is fundamentally dehumanizing. The constant search for new experiences leads to chronic dissatisfaction, with no experience ever being enough. His frantic quest for pleasure is an escape from existential emptiness, and behind Johannes's shiny and sophisticated facade lies a form of anxiety and despair. Among the key philosophical concepts developed by Kierkegaard, anxiety and despair occupy a central place. These notions, far from being mere negative psychological states, are essential existential revelations for Kierkegaard. Anxiety, as Kierkegaard conceives it, is intimately linked to human freedom. In his work, The Concept of Anxiety, he explores this notion in depth. But what exactly is anxiety according to Kierkegaard? How does it differ from mere fear or everyday worry? For Kierkegaard, anxiety is the dizziness of freedom. It arises from the individual's confrontation with the infinite possibilities of existence. Unlike fear, which has a defined object, like fearing a snake, anxiety is indeterminate and lacks a specific focus. It reveals our fundamental freedom, our capacity to choose and project ourselves into the future. Anxiety is not merely a fear or worry about a specific danger, but rather a deep existential feeling that emerges from the possibility of choice. Imagine standing at the edge of a cliff. You feel a dizzying sensation as you look into the void below. This dizziness is not just the fear of falling, but also the anxiety over the freedom you have to jump. The possibility of making a choice, even one as extreme as this, embodies the radical freedom we possess, and this very freedom is a source of anxiety. In daily life, this anxiety manifests when we are faced with important decisions that can change the course of our existence. For example, choosing a career, deciding to marry, or even the simple possibility of changing one's life. Each choice brings with it responsibility and the possibility of regret, creating a state of anxiety. The dizziness of freedom thus illustrates how freedom, far from being solely a source of joy and emancipation, can also provoke a profound sense of anxiety and paralysis in the face of infinite possibilities. But why is anxiety so important for Kierkegaard? Wouldn't it be preferable to seek to eliminate it, to live a serene and trouble-free existence? Kierkegaard argues that anxiety, though painful, is actually a positive and necessary experience. It is the sign of our human condition, of our freedom and responsibility. To flee from anxiety is to flee from our very humanity. This conception of anxiety as revealing our freedom contrasts sharply with the approach of philosophers like Epicurus, who sought to eliminate all forms of disturbance of the soul. For Kierkegaard, such an approach misses the essence of the human condition. In the aesthetic stage, Anxiety often manifests as existential boredom, a chronic dissatisfaction. The individual, in a perpetual quest for new experiences, faces the void hidden behind immediate pleasure. Despair, on the other hand, is explored in depth in novel The Sickness Unto Death. Kierkegaard presents despair not as a simple emotional state, but as a fundamental existential condition. But despair looks like a merely a state of intense sadness or discouragement. Not at all. For Kierkegaard, despair is much deeper. He defines it as an imbalance in the relationship of the self to itself. Despair occurs when we fail to become ourselves, when we refuse to assume our freedom and responsibility. Despair often takes the form of a dispersion of the self, an inability to settle, to commit sustainably. Kierkegaard identifies different forms of despair, ranging from unconscious despair, where the individual is not even aware of their despair, to conscious and defiant despair. But all these forms have in common the refusal or inability of the individual to fully realize themselves. This vision of despair and its overcoming contrasts sharply with the more rationalist approach of philosophers like Spinoza, who sought to overcome sad passions through knowledge. Expect a podcast about Spinoza soon. For Kierkegaard, such an approach is insufficient in the face of the fundamental paradoxes of existence. But is the aesthetic way of life, aesthetic stage, entirely devoid of value? Well, Kierkegaard suggests that despite its limits, this stage can serve as a starting point towards a more authentic existence. It is precisely the experience of anxiety and despair that can push the individual to transcend the aesthetic stage. The awareness of the limitations of the aesthetic way of life can lead to an existential crisis that opens the way to the ethical stage. Now, after touching upon the aesthetic stage through The Seducer's Diary, it is natural to wonder how Kierkegaard envisions the following stages. How does one move from the aesthetic stage to the ethical stage and eventually to the religious stage? What are the challenges and paradoxes inherent in these transitions? These are precisely the questions that Kierkegaard addresses in another of his major works, Concluding Unscientific Postscript to Philosophical Fragments. In this monumental work, Kierkegaard deepens his reflection on the stages of existence, focusing particularly on the ethical and religious stages. But before diving into this complex work, let's take a moment to reflect. What do you think of this idea of progression through different stages of existence? Have you ever experienced similar moments of transition in your own life? How have these transitions affected your understanding of yourself and the world around you? Share your experiences and reflections in the comments. And of course, don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel. Yes, I know, I always forget, but your support really matters. So, as I was saying, The Postscript is undoubtedly one of Søren Kierkegaard's most complex and rich works. Published in 1846 under the pseudonym Climacus, this monumental book represents the culmination of his philosophical reflection on human existence, subjectivity, faith, and the relationship between the individual and truth. As I mentioned earlier, Kierkegaard chooses to publish his works under pseudonyms. This method of writing is itself an expression of his philosophy. The use of pseudonyms, indirect communication, irony, and polemic are all ways of putting into practice his concept of subjective truth. In The Postscript, Kierkegaard takes this method to its peak. He refuses to present his thought systematically, forcing the reader to personally engage in the reflection. This approach contrasts sharply with the dominant philosophical tradition of his time, which is crucial to understanding the scope of his work. The mid-19th century was dominated by Hegel's philosophy, which proposed an all-encompassing system claiming to explain the entirety of reality through a dialectical process. Kierkegaard firmly opposes this approach, which he considers too abstract and disconnected from the concrete experience of the individual. This is why Kierkegaard vehemently opposes Hegel and also criticizes the established Christianity. He denounces a religion that has become too comfortable, too far removed from the paradox and scandal of authentic faith. For Kierkegaard, the problem lies in the pretension of systematic philosophy to grasp the totality of existence. He argues that human existence, in its concreteness and uniqueness, necessarily eludes any attempt at systematization. The Postscript can thus be read as a radical critique of speculative philosophy and an affirmation of the importance of subjectivity and personal engagement. For Kierkegaard, subjectivity is truth is not a mere relativistic statement, but a profound reflection on the nature of human existence. He argues that the most important truths are not objective facts but subjectively lived realities. Crucial life questions, such as the meaning of existence, faith, and love, cannot be approached purely rationally and objectively. They require personal engagement, subjective appropriation. For Kierkegaard, the most important truth is not that of scientific facts or philosophical systems, but that which concerns each individual's existence. Truth, according to him, is not something one possesses, but a mode of being. This emphasis on subjectivity does not mean that everyone can believe whatever they want. On the contrary, Kierkegaard insists on the importance of passion and engagement in the search for truth. The subjectivity he speaks of is an engaged subjectivity, taking seriously the task of existence. Kierkegaard deepens his reflection on the stages of existence, focusing particularly on the ethical and religious stages. Unlike the aesthetic stage, where immediate pleasure is sought, the ethical and religious stages involve a deeper and more lasting engagement. The ethical stage is when one begins to take life seriously. Here, one realizes that choices and commitments have weight and go beyond the mere pursuit of pleasure. It's where one begins to understand the importance of responsibilities towards others and society. Typical examples of this stage are marriage, career, and social engagement. The notion of choice is central in Kierkegaard's philosophy, and it takes on particular importance in the context of the ethical stage. For Kierkegaard, the ethical choice is not simply a one-time decision between different options. It is an act that engages the whole personality, defining who we are and who we want to become. The ethical choice is thus intimately linked to the notion of personal identity. Regarding the implications of this conception of ethical choice, he emphasizes that true ethical choice cannot be made based on a rational calculation of advantages and disadvantages. It involves a leap, a commitment that goes beyond what can be justified purely rationally. But how can we make such choices? On what basis can we decide if a particular commitment is authentically ethical? Authentically ethical may be the best term I found. Here, Kierkegaard suggests that the ultimate criterion is not external to the individual, but resides in the passion and sincerity of one's commitment. Hence, the importance of passion and inwardness in authentic existence. Kierkegaard strongly criticizes what he sees as the tendency of his era to value detached objectivity at the expense of passionate engagement. For him, authentic passion is not a mere fleeting emotion, but a total commitment of the individual. It involves a form of existential intensity, a way of living that engages our entire being. He acknowledges the tension between passion and conscious reflection, but Kierkegaard argues that true passion involves an existential lucidity, an acute awareness of our situation and choices. For Kierkegaard, authentic passion does not oppose reflection, but is its supreme fulfillment. This view of passion as the highest form of reflection stands in stark contrast to the more rationalist approach of philosophers like Kant, who tended to oppose reason to emotions. For Kierkegaard, such a separation is artificial and misses the fundamental unity of human existence. In the postscript, Kierkegaard explores the different forms that this existential passion can take. He notably contrasts aesthetic passion, which remains superficial and changeable, with ethical and religious passion, which involves a deeper and more enduring commitment. Thus, the authentic ethical choice is one that engages our entire being, that fully commits us. However, this vision of ethical choice raises many questions. Does it not risk leading to a form of moral subjectivism, where anyone could justify any action in the name of the sincerity of their commitment? How does Kierkegaard reconcile this view with the necessity of serious ethical reflection and responsibility towards others? The notion of commitment in Kierkegaard's thought is closely linked to choice. Commitment represents the continuity of choice over time, the way we shape our existence through our repeated decisions and actions. Kierkegaard explores the different forms that commitment can take. He notably distinguishes aesthetic commitment, which remains superficial and changeable, from ethical and religious commitment, which involves a deeper transformation of the individual. But what really characterizes the ethical stage? Is it just a matter of following social norms? Kierkegaard thinks not. For him, being at the ethical stage means deciding, in full consciousness, to take responsibility and engage in relationships. It's more than just following rules. It's creating one's own identity through one's choices. Kierkegaard speaks of the importance of continuity and coherence in ethical life. Unlike the aesthetic stage, where one can reinvent oneself every day, here it is about staying true to one's commitments and values over the long term. But isn't this constancy a form of rigidity? How to reconcile commitment and openness to change? For Kierkegaard, authentic commitment is not a limitation of freedom, but its deepest expression. By committing, the individual does not simply submit to external constraints, but affirms their will to give direction and meaning to their life. Kierkegaard suggests that ethical commitment, far from being a constraint, is actually an expression of freedom. By choosing to commit, one affirms their freedom in a deeper way than in the mere pursuit of immediate pleasure. However, despite the importance of the ethical stage, Kierkegaard suggests that there is still a missing dimension, a higher form of existence, that he considers the pinnacle of human existence. This is where the religious stage comes in, which Kierkegaard considers the summit of human existence. In this stage, anxiety reaches its peak. It becomes anxiety in the face of the absolute, the dizzying awareness of standing before God. Despair, paradoxically, can become a path to faith, a recognition of our radical insufficiency that opens us to transcendence. But what does it really mean to be at the religious stage? Is it simply about adhering to an institutional religion? No, for Kierkegaard, it is not just about following a religion. The religious stage goes far beyond mere adherence to a set of religious beliefs or practices. It involves a leap of faith, a radical decision that transcends conventional rationality and ethics. The individual enters into a direct relationship with the absolute, which Kierkegaard identifies as God in the Christian context. But how do we understand this leap of faith? Is it an abandonment of reason, a form of irrationality? Not at all. Kierkegaard insists that faith surpasses what reason can comprehend. It is not irrational, but super-rational. Faith does not contradict reason, but goes beyond what reason can grasp. Faith involves a paradox, a tension between the demands of faith and those of ethics or reason, a tension between what our reason dictates and what we deeply believe. To illustrate what he means by faith, Kierkegaard uses the biblical example of Abraham and Isaac, ready to sacrifice his son Isaac at God's command, an act that seems totally irrational and contrary to morality. From an ethical point of view, Abraham's action is monstrous, but from a religious perspective, it is the supreme expression of faith. Abraham chooses to trust God, to take that leap of faith, even if he cannot understand the reason behind this request. It is this ultimate act of faith, this unwavering trust in God despite the apparent absurdity of the situation, that defines true faith according to Kierkegaard. Kierkegaard uses the image of the leap of faith to highlight the discontinuity between rational reflection and existential commitment. The most important questions of existence, the meaning of life, the relationship to the absolute, cannot be resolved through detached reflection, but require total personal commitment. But here, some might say that this could lead to a form of fideism, where any belief could be justified in the name of faith. Doesn't this vision of faith risk justifying all sorts of morally reprehensible actions in the name of religion? How does Kierkegaard distinguish the true leap of faith from a mere act of irrationality? Kierkegaard is aware of this danger and strives to address it. He knows very well the risk that this might seem to justify morally reprehensible and irrational actions and an abandonment of reason in favor of blind belief. It is rather a recognition of the limits of reason when faced with the ultimate questions of existence. He emphasizes that the religious stage does not annul ethics but temporarily suspends it in a direct relationship with the absolute, or God. This suspension is not arbitrary or capricious, but the result of intense inner struggle and total personal commitment. According to Kierkegaard, the true knight of faith, as he calls one who has taken the leap of faith, does not seek to impose his vision on others or justify his actions rationally. The knight of faith, according to him, outwardly resembles anyone else. His peculiarity lies in his inwardness, in his secret relationship with the absolute that transforms his entire existence. The knight of faith is the individual who can gracefully embrace life. Kierkegaard expresses this in Either Or as follows, and I quote, "When around one everything has become silent, solemn as a clear starlit night when the soul comes to be alone in the whole world, then before one there appears, not an extraordinary human being, but the eternal power itself, then the heavens open, and the eye chooses itself, or, more correctly, receives itself. Then the personality receives the accolade of knighthood that ennobles it for an eternity. The true knight of faith, according to Kierkegaard, is not someone who believes blindly, but someone who has fully recognized the uncertainty and paradox. He represents the moment when the individual, faced with uncertainty and paradox, chooses nonetheless to fully commit. Faith remains a profoundly personal and subjective matter. Kierkegaard sees his love for Regine Olsen as a spiritual trial, a way to understand the nature of faith and sacrifice, a sacrifice that, according to him, brings him closer to God while separating him from the world. This tension between the ethical and the religious is at the heart of his reflection on the stages of existence. By renouncing Regine Olsen, Kierkegaard believes he is performing an act of faith, submitting to divine will. This spiritual perspective is central to his work. Kierkegaard sees his life as a quest for redemption, an attempt to draw closer to God through suffering and renunciation. His love for Regine Olsen thus becomes a metaphor for his relationship with the divine, an impossible and sublime love that transcends everyday reality. It is important to note that Kierkegaard does not present these stages of existence as a linear and obligatory path. Each individual can find themselves at different moments of their life in one or another of these stages, and some may never progress beyond the first stage. The progression is not automatic. It requires conscious and often difficult choices. Kierkegaard reminds us of the value of risk, of the leap into the unknown that any authentic decision entails. His reflection on subjectivity and personal commitment remains highly relevant. Faced with the temptation of relativism or nihilism, Kierkegaard proposes a demanding path, that of a passionate appropriation of existence, of an authentic relationship with oneself, and with the absolute. Kierkegaard's philosophy may initially seem outdated, but isn't it, on the contrary, more relevant than ever? His insistence on the uniqueness of existence, the importance of passion and commitment, his reflection on anxiety as a revelation of our freedom, on despair as a symptom of our problematic relationship with ourselves, on faith as a paradoxical commitment, all of this pushes us towards existential awakening. He encourages us to break free from the slumber of everyday life, offering us valuable tools to navigate these troubled waters, to face anxiety and despair not as states to flee from, but as experiences that reveal our human condition. Engaging means renouncing certain possibilities, closing doors, accepting the responsibility of our choices. The task of existence is to be oneself, to become oneself. Thank you.